we celebrate our nation, our independence. But we also celebrate every time we gather on Sunday morning, the resurrection of our Lord. And that is an independence beyond compare. Gina is at the General Synod of the United Church of Christ, and down in Baltimore. And so I have been dragged out of the pasture once again. She wants me to remind you that, and this is in the bulletin, I believe, that All Saints Church is having a speaker on the history of immigration next Sunday, July 9th. And there are posters around the church about that. And then on August 3rd, there's another program called Ask a Muslim Anything. That also sounds very interesting. Not often in this community that we get to have open conversations with Muslims. And so this is a great opportunity for us to ask questions. Anything is fair game. Are there any other announcements that need to be made? You can't hear me very well.
Turn your mic on.
Ah, turn the mic on. That's what this thing is. All right, now, how are we doing? Is that better?
A little better.
Well, this is the one that I'm supposed to be using, so we'll hope for that. Okay, then let's prepare for worship as we listen to the prelude.
Thank you.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts.
My soul longs for the courts of the Lord.
My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God.
Happy are those who live in your house, singing your praise.
Our opening hymn is number 85 in the Black Hymnal. I woke up this morning, and we will sing verse 1 and 2, and then verse 1.
Will you pray with me? As we prepare to hear this ancient word, O God, make it present to us by your Holy Spirit, that we may know that this word is for us and for now. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'm going to read the Romans passage first, and then incorporate the psalm as a part of my sermon. So listen to the voice of Paul writing to the Romans. If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? Now in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. A friend from this church emailed me an article by Mariana Alessandri, who teaches philosophy at the University of Texas. The title, In Praise of Lost Causes. And I wondered what his point was. Why me? Alessandri recalls that after Spain was routed by the United States in the Spanish-American War in 1898, the Spanish philosopher Miguel de Unamuno resurrected Spain's own patron saint of lost causes, Don Quixote de la Mancha. Quixote is remembered most and by most of us for riding a bony old nag, wearing a suit of armor with a lance and tilting at windmills. Or you may remember that marvelous song from the musical Men of La Mancha, to dream the impossible dream. That's Quixote. After the war, writes Alessandri, Unamuno urged his fellow Spaniards to practice Quixotism, which meant adopting the moral courage necessary to fight for lost causes without caring what the world thinks. She continues, Unamuno believed that it was not Quixote, but Sancho, his squire, who was delusional, because he was firm in his belief that windmills are not worth charging, and more broadly, that unwinnable battles are not worth fighting. This kind of sanity, Unamuno argued, actually results in paralysis. Political theorist Joshua Dienstag argues that Quixote didn't charge the windmill because he thought he would defeat it, but because he concluded it was the right thing to do. Likewise, if we want to be legitimate actors in the world, Unamuno would say, that we must be willing to lose the fight. If we can give up the common sense belief that deems only winnable fights worth fighting, we can then adopt Unamuno's moral courage and become Quixotic pessimists. Pessimists because we recognize that our odds of losing are very high, and Quixotic because we fight anyway. And then the article includes this point. Quixotic pessimism will not go over well in public. If you choose this life, Unamuno says, you will face this disbelief, judgment, and ridicule. Okay, so what shall we do? We choose between the sanity, the caution, the wisdom of Sancho, or the moral courage of Don Quixote. Well, I don't need to detail for you the long list of unwinnable battles that we face today. Can we afford to be complacent, to just accept it as it is and hope that these problems will resolve themselves? Or that the super rich who have their hands on the levers of power will be moved to do the right thing? Or shall we adopt a crazy courage and tilt at the huge machines of our culture? to suggest that there's a third opportunity, a third option, especially for us church folks. For a long time, I have begun my days with a reading from the Book of Psalms. And lately, I have found them to be profoundly relevant to the situation today. Let me share with you one of my favorites and the inspiration that it gives me, my own Quixotism, if you will. Listen to this Psalm, 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He upholds the orphan and the widow, but the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. Walk through these verses with me. You may find it helpful to open a pew Bible. You can find this text on page 593. Or, as I was taught when I was a kid, to find the Psalms by opening the Bible in the middle. Unless there's all kinds of stuff before and after that works. And it works in these pew Bibles. Just open it in the middle, turn to 146 on page 593. Like many of the Psalms, it begins with a word of praise. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Now, this is not a momentary thrill we're talking about here, but a lifelong praise. The song of my heart. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Now be careful. Praise is not window dressing. Praise is not just a hi, how are you? It's not just a couple of happy words before we get into the meat of the subject. Praise is subversive. It tends to turn things upside down. And the reason for that is that praise indicates a loyalty. It indicates an allegiance. Praise implies submission to a higher authority. So when we praise God, we are indicating our discipleship, our willingness to do as God wants us to do. Remember that old adage, keep smiling, people will wonder what you're up to. Praising God in the midst of chaos. Praising God when people are clamoring for your loyalty and your support is a profoundly political act. So be careful. And the psalmist immediately moves to a warning. Be careful whom you praise. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals in whom there is no help. When their breath departs, they return to the earth. On that very day, their plans perish. Now, the psalmist doesn't call out any particular prince by name. He doesn't suggest a Republican or a Democrat. No particular character or policy is rejected. Princes, like all of us, are passing, temporal, mortal. When our breath departs, our power, our influence, our plans come to an end. And therefore, we need to consider whether they are worthy of our praise in that lifelong, continuing song. In contrast, the psalmist goes on to affirm, happy are those whose help is the God of Jacob. Jacob? Well, remember that Jacob's other name was Israel. Happy are those whose help is the God of Israel. This is our God as a people. This is the God who has a history with us. This is the God who, the covenanting God, whose faithfulness to us is proved over and over again in our own story. The God who keeps faith forever. The God who executes justice for the oppressed. The God who feeds the hungry. And we're not talking about the food pantry here. We're talking about all of us who have food to eat provided by our God. And we can go on past the experience of the psalmist to say this God, our God, loved the world so much that God gave the only Son that we might be delivered from the power of death. So the psalmist says, happy are those whose hope is in the Lord their God, who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. Now think about it. George Washington got a bridge named after him, New Hampshire's highest peak. God's credits include the Milky Way. The man of La Mancha would have loved these next two verses. The Lord sets the prisoners free, opens the eyes of the blind, lifts up those who are bowed down, loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers, upholds the orphan and the widow, but contorts the way of the wicked. Now we can see these two verses from two perspectives. If we are imprisoned, blind, bowed down, alien, poor, and helpless, then God is our present help in trouble. On the other hand, from God's point of view, this is the agenda. This is God's intention. This is the plan for the way human life is supposed to be. This is the measure that we use to judge our society. Helping the poor, the bowed down, ranks way above making tons of money. Setting a prisoner free from opioid addiction rates far higher than public acclaim. And you can go on to make your own contrast. Then in this one negative sentence, the Revised Standard Version says, the way of the wicked God brings to ruin. Another translator says, God contorts the way of the wicked. It reminds me of another psalm that says of the wicked, let them fall by their own counsels. I think that's one of the most chilling of warnings. Imagine that we were limited by our own best thoughts. That our own human creativity was the most we could hope for. Let them fall by their own counsels. The way of the wicked may bring short-term gain, but in the end it's self-destructive, messed up, contorted. And then here's the bottom line. The Lord will reign forever. Your God for all generations. Praise the Lord. God is faithful. Forever. God executes justice for all generations. God feeds the hungry, frees the prisoner, opens the blind eyes forever. Welcomes the stranger, cares for the orphan and widow, read poor and helpless. Today and tomorrow and always. Is this chaotic insanity? I don't think so. I am prodded by the Psalms to keep striving for the best I know, even when the cause seems lost. Being as faithful as I can to God's intention, even when it seems to go against the current. Rejoicing in God, whose faithfulness I trust, even in the midst of betrayal. I believe that God, in God's own way and God's own time, will execute justice. And I want to be there whenever and however that happens, praising my God. Our hymn of prayer is number 591 in the Black Hymnal. This is my song. Gina asks, our prayers today, we remember the UCC meeting in Baltimore during that General Synod. These are tough times to be a denomination of the Christian Church. Challenging times. And it is good for us to pray not just for our own pastor, but for all of those who gather in this collective body of faith to determine direction and to set priorities. So let's pray for Gina and for the General Synod. It seems that every week brings new stories of shootings, of disasters of one sort or another, and we pray for those who are victims of violence of natural troubles. And we pray, as we do every week, for peace and for peacemakers. Are there other concerns to raise this morning, or joys to share? Yes, Carol.
Joy for this past week of Vacation Bible School, for all the shiny kids' faces and enthusiasm of all volunteers. And I have a concern, prayer for my son Jason and his wife Joanne as the doctors try to determine the cause of her peripheral neuropathy. I think she's 38 years old. So they're looking at some nasty stuff, and hopefully it's just idiopathic, but they've been going through a lot of tests. Thank you.
Carol is recognizing the effort of many volunteers in a successful Vacation Bible School this past week. It was my pleasure to join with the band in the final presentation where all the kids got to sing their songs, and what a trip, what a joy that was. And they sang with such gusto and fervor. It was a pleasure. And Carol also asks us to pray for her daughter-in-law who is having vision issues. Yes, yes.
Prayer of thanks for Carol Thompson, who's a member here. She had a medical scare last week.
I'm sorry, but I cannot hear you with that distance.
A prayer of thanks for Carol Thompson. She had a medical scare a few days ago, but she seems to be all right.
Carol Thompson. I know who you mean. Prayers for Carol Thompson, who is improving. Thank you. Are there other concerns or joys to share? Yes.
Prayers for my cousin, my second cousin, Shana, who was in a very bad car accident last week. She's home, but it was bad enough that she had to quit her job and move
to Oh my goodness. Elizabeth's second cousin, who was in a car accident and has had to quit her job to recover. Yes, Mark.
For our son Jeff, who's under treatment right now, and everything seems to be going very well.
For the lackey son Jeff, who's under treatment and seems to be doing well, yes.
And I'd like to go home and call in again today and repeat my message. Jeff, you have no idea how many people are praying for you.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Let him know that. And in fact, you know, it's a good thing for us to do that as a regular matter, to let people know as you raise names for us, to let them know that this church has lifted them up in prayer. And on this day, let us give thanks for our country and for the freedoms that we enjoy, for those who have that sacrifice made it possible for us to continue to enjoy those freedoms. Let's join together in silent prayer, and then I will lead you briefly in a pastoral prayer. Let us pray together. mighty God, maker of heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them. We rejoice in the majesty around us, and even more, we rejoice in your faithfulness to us, day by day and year by year, lifetime by lifetime. You reign forever for all generations, and we praise you. O Lord, in these days when patriotism seems to wear such partisan colors, we give thanks for this nation and for the blessings that are common to all of us. And we ask, O God, that we may be moved to appreciate the variety, the diversity, the wonder of all the contributions that citizens of this land make. And give us grace to learn to listen to each other. We pray for those who need special care, for those whose lives are disrupted by illness or accident. We give thanks for healing gifts. We pray for peace in the world. And especially we lift up refugees forced from their homes and wondering where home will be next. Support us, O God, in all that we do that is faithful and just. Put a song in our hearts and give us the gift of praise. We pray in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. This is the Lord's table. In Jesus' name, I welcome you to this table, whoever you are. This is an open table, an open invitation. It is Jesus' table. Will you pray with me in the prayer of confession? Lord Jesus, you graciously welcome all sorts of people to your table. We confess that we are heartbreaking. We like to have our companions look like us, talk like us, vote like us, share the same class, and be nice. We admit that by any holy measure, we would not be invited to this meal. But you urge us to come, and we are changed. Thank you. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven. how many times in the course of my life I have said these words. On the night in which he was betrayed. And I find them weighing more and more heavily on me. On the night in which he was betrayed. On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and offered it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you," on the night when they betrayed him. And after supper, after Judas had gone, Jesus took the cup and again gave thanks and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you eat and drink in remembrance of me." In Jesus' name, I bid you come. Thank you. connects with me. Such a gift, O God. Such wondrous love poured out for us unstintingly, without qualification. We give you thanks for this great gift, and we ask that we may go from this place to show in what we say and what we do the gratitude we feel. In Jesus' name, amen. Psalm asks, what shall I give? What shall I do in response to the goodness of God? And the answer from immemorial time has been, we give in turn. This is not a payback. The scripture leaves no doubt about it, that generosity is as good as it gets. This is the way God intends to be with us and intends us to be with each other. And so, it is a gift to be generous. Let us bring our offerings with thanksgiving to the God who gives us all that we have and all that we need. Closing hymn is, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies, in the Red Hymnal.
Thank you.
serve the Lord. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always.